thank you for joining. This is Insight with Insiders. One of the many things I'm extremely passionate about is empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise. That is why I started the podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked Adrian Nelson, with Staffing Industry Analyst, to join me. Adrian is the Senior Director of Global Membership Products for Staffing Industry Analyst and leads the corporate membership experience. Her responsibilities include thought leadership, product marketing, and management for SIA's membership products and webinars globally. She is passionate about delivery, strategy, and membership care for workforce solution clients of all sizes. Adrian's goal is to ensure that the entire workforce solutions ecosystem SIA serves realizes the maximum value from staffing industry analysts' products and research. She is a reputed speaker and writer for industry associations and publications. She holds a BA in economics. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Adrian Nelson with Staffing Industry Analysts. Welcome, Adrian.
Thank you, Julie. So nice to see you and talk to the TRICOM group, as it were. Thank you for having me.
Well, thank you for joining us. I really appreciate it. It is great to see you finally after so long. And we're finally going to be in person in a couple of weeks. I think
I can't wait.
Great. Yes, I'm excited as well. So thank you for agreeing to join me today. And I'm excited to hear your perspective and your colleagues' perspective from SIA's, what your research has found out. So let's get started with what's happening in staffing for 2022.
Well, you know, Julie, when the economy sneezes, staffing gets a cold.
Yeah.
The first to feel an economic impact and the first to feel a recovery, right?
Right.
So we're really experiencing the results of not just a cold, but a full-blown global pandemic now. You know, we estimated an 11% decline in 2020, pretty significant decline mm-hmm. for staffing, but with an equally outsized growth of 16% in 2021.
Wow.
4% for 2022. And remember, you know, growth 2017 through 19 was like 3 to 4%. We kind of bounce around there overall. Mm-hmm. You know, as with the broader economy, COVID did not affect the staffing industry equally. Travel nurse was up by 40% in 2021, and it just keeps going. Light industrial still strong, but more tempered. Thank you, Amazon and many others.
Yep.
Hospitality really suffered.
Mm-hmm.
And a few others. You know, many of the staffing businesses were down significantly in 2020, but they rebounded for 2021. Our September forecast gives you more details on that. But I would expect near-term growth in the staffing industry to be driven by that big sneeze, mm-hmm. economic recovery. And the caveat would be labor shortages. This will be a bigger factor than any kind of tech innovation or talent platforms. You know, automation is here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's increased staffing platform technology usage that provides advantages that'll make the industry bigger by drawing in new clients and new candidates. Nurse staffing and industrial have both seen the benefits of automation. But there's good news. Really good news in that, you know, we really expect that every segment, every single one of the industry will see double digit growth this year. In many cases, as part of the bounce back from declines in 2020, but growth's also being driven by rising pay rates, particularly in the industrial and travel nurse segments. And there's more, but I'll stop now and see if you have other questions.
Okay, fantastic. So you're talking about the staffing segments, you're seeing double digits next year for growth, which is very positive. Are there mm-hmm. other segments that are going to experience challenges that you haven't talked about for 2022?
I think hospitality will continue to see challenges.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the staffing industry growth in general is being driven by a 6% U.S. GDP growth, federal spending, monetary policy, helped by a massive COVID vaccination campaign. You know, there's 10.4 million job openings as of August,
wow.
And the staffing industry is seeing levels of job orders just never witnessed before. It's good to be in staffing right now, but tough to find talent. So that's going to drive everything. I think hospitality has the talent. It's looking for demand, right? Mm-hmm. At this point, and the demand is coming back. I don't know about you, but I'm taking a vacation.
Right. right.
And I think a lot of other people are seeing their loved ones, right? So the travel and tourism industry should get a nice boost from that. You know, there's stimulus programs that are coming under both that have been under both administrations that are contributing to household savings, that are giving people an increased, you know, ability to be selective in returning to work, intensifying an already white hot job market. And states are actually reporting the lowest level of unemployment claims during the pandemic. So new claims are down significantly, which, you know, is good and good for people who are working. But the wild card is the emergence of new variants, which could have like a similar unexpected impact as has Delta. Delta did. There's a variant of interest identified about every few weeks so far. So vaccines seem to be working. But, you know, when we talk about really what parts of staffing look good and which ones are having more challenges, you know, I can say that a lot is looking really, really good. The SIA Bullhorn staffing indicator that was published on October 22nd said that temporary staffing hours worked last week were up 21% compared to the corresponding week a year ago.
Wow.
And that's largely explained by the pullback in temporary staffing that occurred last year, you know, due to the pandemic. Hours worked in professional occupations, especially, were up 31% year over year. IT, healthcare, finance, engineering. Commercial was up 13% year over year. Those are big numbers.
They're huge numbers.
Our Pulse survey, which is a smaller group, right? It's a smaller survey. But it showed a median increase in August of 26% year over year. And that was down from 32% in June. The travel nurse segment, again, impressive. Mm-hmm. 85% in August, median year over year revenue growth. 85%. Outside of healthcare, strongest growth came from the office clerical segment, 21%, life sciences, 21%, and IT, 19%. You know, life sciences, I have a good friend who's with a pharma company, and they are just trying to keep their workers close. Lots of retention bonuses, you know, lots of extra weeks paid. So they're using some tactics to keep those workers close. I think that's the name of the game, is keeping your workers. You know, we asked, what impact the current wave of rising COVID-19 cases are having on your staffing business this month in the Pulse survey. And the theme that emerged was definitely low supply and high demand for temporary work.
Right, right. I was reading your survey, your September survey. It was very interesting. I was surprised to see clerical grow as much as it is, because it seems like the whole work from home has been an issue with some of the staffing to deal with that. Having people use temporary to work from home, you know?
Yeah.
So what are you seeing with that? Do you have an insight?
You know, what's interesting, one of the areas of growth, and I didn't know this, maybe you're aware of it, but was, you know, there's a lot of social media monitoring jobs mm-hmm. that are going to temporary help firms. And that's getting to be a big deal, right? So that's one area of growth. Obviously, you know, call centers and things like that can be done from home. And some of those office clerical, which falls into that office clerical area as well.
Yeah, the call centers is where we've seen the growth the most, is because you can do that from home. Definitely. Yes, great. And life sciences, of course, you're right. Healthcare, unbelievable growth there. What, any suggestions if a staffing owner is saying, okay, I want to break into a new segment? Do you have any suggestions? Because I hear that all the time from clients. I want to get into healthcare. It's going crazy. And they have no experience in healthcare.
Healthcare is tricky. I mean, you know, the segment that you were in healthcare, what I would suggest is maybe going, you know, education's red hot right now. You know, when we're looking at education, That segment, it's more, you know, staffing of substitute teachers and teacher aides, you know, that type of thing. Kelly, who does, you know, a lot of work in that segment, their education staffing revenue in the second quarter of 21 reached 90% wow. of pre-pandemic level. So they're really doing a great job there. And there's probably some room for others. It's, you know, we're forecasting a whopping 35% in growth in the segment this year. So 7% expansion next year. I think it's fun to watch very carefully. I mean, if you can handle healthcare staffing, credentialing, et cetera, education might be a diversification option. Another one is maybe pharma, life sciences. Mm-hmm. You know, it's booming as well. Projects related to COVID-19, vaccines, diagnostic tests, which is what, you know, my friend's company does. You know, also fresh funding rounds that have launched numerous biotech startups. And several large pharma companies have announced extensive investments in R&D and manufacturing infrastructure. We forecast 8% growth next year.
Wow. Wow. That's great insight. Yeah. I just tell people when they're looking at healthcare, if they've never been in healthcare, the credentialing is a big piece. It's a big deal. And we're going to talk about automation in a minute. And if you don't have the automation for that, don't get into healthcare, because that's a whole nother beast to have with healthcare is on the automation for credentialing and scheduling, I think, because you really have to stay on top of that. So you got to do your research and understand that industry before you get into it. And I think that healthcare can be great, but you better understand that.
You better know what you're doing.
Right. You better know what you're doing. So you better have somebody from that has experience in there.
And it's moving fast right now. I mean, just unbelievable, as I mentioned before. You know, the other segment is kind of a really hot one right now is direct hire, permanent placement.
Yes.
And temp to perm conversion fees. We have upgraded our forecast to 35% expansion in direct hire this year due to, you know, strong economic growth and unusually high levels of retirements and voluntary terminations.
Right. You know, I've talked to people that say that they're up 75% or more in direct hire, greater. Wow. Because people, somebody like us who used to do just temp to perm, we're going straight direct hire because that's the only way you're going to hire or get somebody in here, great candidate. Because why would a candidate come on to you for temp to perm if they know they can go somewhere else for direct hire?
So you got it.
Right. You have to look at that. The other thing I'm hearing is employers aren't understanding that the cost for employees today is going up. You have to look at that increase, especially in warehousing. I was told this past week that you're looking at like Costco, who is hiring, you know, their warehouse people, $19 and $20 to $21 an hour for warehouse people. That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. And, you know, Amazon's driving that too. You know, and truck drivers is the other one. I mean, the demand for truck drivers is just astounding. And it's not just here, it's in the UK and Europe as well. Also, you know, Heidrick & Struggles, who does obviously a lot of firm placement, their revenue, they announced, I think it was yesterday or the day before in our daily news, their revenue rose 82%, a record for them in firm placement, executive search.
Wow.
That's big.
It's a
good time for most right now.
Yes, it is. So let's move over to automation. You talked a little bit, you spoke a little bit about it earlier on. We're always hearing a lot about it, automation and staffing platforms. And in the last year and a half, that's all we've been hearing, but now more than ever. What's new for staffing in automation?
You know, it's a growth driver actually in our forecast. The blossoming use of staffing platform technology by staffing firms is just a huge factor. We believe that the speed, automation, and advantages of staffing platforms are enlarging the staffing industry by drawing in new clients and new candidates. I mean, it's really become apparent in obviously nurse staffing and in industrial staffing, think, you know, Blue Crew, that type of thing. Mm-hmm. It's starting to gain wider adoption in other segments of staffing. I mean, you know, the pandemic has served as a monumental point of inflection, particularly for travel nurses as hospital operations transformed really almost overnight. Mm-hmm. It's faster, better, cheaper sometimes. Mm-hmm. I think that traditional staffing firms are increasingly perceiving value in deploying platforms as part of an omni-channel approach, along with the mix of traditional platform-based staffing. You know, temporary staffing platforms have historically been synonymous with really the idea of just-in-time staffing. And that really lends itself to high turnover, lower wage, blue-collar roles, such as, you know, those in industrial, like Blue Crew, hospitality, maybe Indeed Flex's company, call centers, job and talent, events, Bonolo, and retail, Flexi. We're seeing three pathways where staffing firms are actually flipping the switch to digital platforms. They're developing them internally, number one, acquisitions, number two, and they utilizing staffing platforms as a service as well. And the benefits really, Julie, they are not universal across the segments. The higher up the complexity curve, the more challenges arise for a self-service model.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, well, I tell clients the speed of hiring is really critical right now. So if you have a mobile app, can't use something with mobile app, iPads, something where the whole experience and how fast that experience can be is really critical and crucial to your business. It really can, and no matter what industry you're in, really.
Yeah. I mean, everyone's looking for a faster, seamless online experience, and they expect it with applying and hiring too. Mm-hmm. And there's, you know, there continues to be a growing selection of solutions and automations. Also, that ATS and firms that focus on seamless engagement experiences are constantly innovating, improving, and offering. I mean, the thing that you got to know if you're going to, if you want to find out if your market is suitable for a temporary staffing platform is, you know, that helps, right? Highly structured assignment links, easily verified hard skills, high volume, variable demand, high repeatability of demand, high price elasticity, fast time to fill requirements, and minimal pre-screening requirements. And you can find out more in our temporary staffing platform report that we published.
Okay, cool. Very good. Excellent. Okay, so let's go on to COVID. How do we leverage the knowledge that we gained during the COVID to improve time to market and think outside of the box?
Well, we sure did learn a lot, didn't we?
You and I talked about it.
We
no longer sign contracts in person anymore or send out overnights for that.
Yeah, and I'm thinking of the money that saves you alone, you know, that's just like...
it's a no-brainer.
Yeah, the pandemic really accelerated existing trends in remote work and e-commerce and automation. Mm-hmm. I mean, roughly... 3/4 of people using digital channels, whatever digital channel you use, wherever you dial in, for the first time during the pandemic, say they will continue using them, as you did, Julie, when things return to normal, whatever normal is, according to McKinsey's latest Consumer Pulse survey. The genie's out of the bottle. You know, you're going to have to embrace remote when it makes sense. It's a competitive advantage. At times for some firms. In recruiting, I mean, professional recruiting pool just got a whole lot wider for staffing firms, right? Because people can work from home and it's been proven and tested. I mean, tools like DocuSign, Zoom, I mean, the growth alone of the webinars that I manage has been phenomenal. We sold out of webinars and that was 6 months ago. So, you know, and we have great attendance. People are using those tools. Also, video interviewing and video conferencing have seen the largest spike in activity. You know, there's a huge uptick in use by staffing, recruitment, and pretty much everybody else. Mm-hmm. You know, because they leverage, you know, and facilitate communication and relationship building with, you know, your candidates, your clients, your teams. I think that also when it comes to automation, agencies have had to ramp up their use of analytics since COVID-19 to better understand performance and make decisions about where they can invest resources. They just need to increase the use of automation and AI with a thinner margin for error than in the past. Automating, you know, time-consuming manual task and freeing up time and resources is even more important.
Yeah, I found that industries, clients that were in social media heavily before the pandemic benefited it because everybody went to social media.
Yeah,
weren't absolutely in the offices. And so they benefited from that. Like us, we're heavy in social media. So we benefited from having that presence already and continuing that presence in social media. Because when we stop going to shows, stop having conferences, absolutely, stop having mailings, because why can't we, you're not doing mailings because nobody's in the office any longer.
Right.
You had to use social media and you had that presence already. You had that audience. Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, the use of LinkedIn is even more prevalent than before.
And, yeah, right. And you had to look at ways, you had to look at different ways to even use LinkedIn from what we did before COVID. Yes.
Yep.
So how are firms handling the newest challenges related to COVID? We've got the vaccines mandates coming right down the pipeline. I'm hearing a lot of, we're going to wait and see. What happens, the mentality of, we really don't know if this is going to go through next week or the next 2 weeks. What are you seeing or hearing?
Well, there are some headwinds from business groups, but it's here. I think it's mm-hmm. pretty close. It's going to be probably an OSHA requirement, fairly soon. It is for firms with 100 or more employees. I know that if you're worried, you're not alone. A SHRM survey found that 80% of organizations with 100 or more workers are worried about the amount of time they will have to spend enforcing or tracking employees' vaccination status or test status. So you're not alone. Business groups, including ASA, are asking the Biden administration to delay the employer vaccine mandate or change it in some way. Until after the end of the year holiday season. That is not ASA, but business groups are asking. That was reported on CNBC. And some are asking the administration to wait, arguing that the mandate could increase labor shortages and supply chain problems. It could affect some industries more than others, trucking, healthcare, and aviation, some of the sectors making headlines recently.
Right.
And staffing firms, I think, are reacting to the upcoming mandate in their own ways, informed by, whatever their unique circumstances are. Some have been ready to mandate vaccines for months and just needed this from the government. Others, for some others, the mandate, really represents a governmental overreach that will disrupt workforces.
Mm-hmm.
Although current research shows, only a small fraction of workers are choosing to quit in opposition to vaccine mandates that are already in place. This could be due to a variety of factors, right? Including industry, like healthcare workers may be more inclined to get vaccinated. But I know I'm doing a health and safety panel at healthcare. My panelists, they did mention, that how we're talking about how they handle healthcare workers who don't want to get vaccinated. For now, I guess employers will need to wait until OSHA releases more details, but there's some steps that can be taken, in the meantime to prepare, distributing employee communications ahead of it. There's some tools. I know SAA has a COVID resource center. ASA has some great information too. SHRM as well. Littler has a chart if you're interested in state by state. Littler actually has a chart that they update frequently. It was updated when I looked October 25th. And it gives you some basic information on the mandates issued at the federal and state levels and covers directives. So, and then there's finally, technology that you might want to look at to track and manage. Some background check companies are creating digital wallets. Mm-hmm. Big Clear, Sterling, some others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we use Clear. American Staffing Association used it, and I know you guys
used it. We used it,
It was really nice, easy to use, easy to upload your information. Mm-hmm. I think it's a great tool to track it for different organizations and companies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I had heard from a client who said, I'm going to look at this as an opportunity for revenue stream. He's going to start offering testing to his clients. So, there's always a way to spin it and go, well, maybe there's a revenue stream here. So that's, you never know.
You gotta look at things. Do that, right? You know, Brother sees lemons, we see lemonade.
Right. So I said, go for it. You go for it. But he said, yeah, why not offer testing for his clients? And especially when he's in big distribution centers that have 100, a couple hundred people. So kudos to him. All right, in wrapping things up, what are you and your colleagues seeing as opportunities in a post-COVID world and future trends?
Okay, so, you know, future trends, we are, as an industry, we are primed for transformational change. We've kind of been plugging along, a little bit of change at a time, right? But to look at the future, we really want to look at the past. Times of economic upheaval have always resulted in new companies with transformative business models. Think Google in 1998 and Salesforce 1999. Google had automated search for manual, Salesforce cloud computing, now it's standard, right? Uber and Airbnb in 2009, they both brought together buyers and sellers and markets that hadn't even seen possible. Mm-hmm. They're still changing and adapting like staffing will. In our industry, we see a similar pattern. Remember GDP declining in 2008 and 2009 at the same time, VMS adoption increased, more than doubling and reaching half of large enterprise buyers. I know that's not sometimes very popular with staffing firms, but it's here, it's stayed, and staffing's still growing. And that didn't put anybody out of business. It's the same driver, you know, a search for new, more efficient business models driven by economic upheaval. Today, we're seeing several interrelated reinforcing trends that are really driving business model innovation. There's digital transformation, which is really ongoing for the last decade, right? It was just rapidly accelerated by COVID.
Right.
Remote work. It required changes to work processes implemented in months that otherwise they have taken a decade or longer, right? Our acceptance of remote work. And personally, you know, our organization was not a big work from home place. It was, we like to come to the office, and we have made that jump. And, you know, others are different. There's a transference of expectations, right? There's an increasing expectation that a seamless digital experience of ordering a product on Amazon or a ride from Uber should be made available to all other experiences, consumer and, you know, B2B. And following that, obviously, is the growth of a digital native cohort. I mean, millennials, they expect a digital first approach, and they're making up an even larger portion of the workforce each year. I think our industry is really innovative and resilient and extremely responsive to changing market conditions. That's what makes our industry, right?
Right.
I think it remains to be seen if we'll see substantial growth due to technical innovation. One of the big questions, you know, that we have is that the tech platforms are also competing for talent and often winning.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a little bit of a threat, but it's an opportunity at the same time, kind of wolf in the hen house. The, you know, correlation of growth of Uber and the millions of workers they employed and Amazon that might have otherwise worked for staffing firms, it certainly made it harder for staffing firms and retailers to hire. Some feared, you know, the contraction when VMS was, gained widespread adoption, but they actually, you know, that correlated to a period of growth in the industry.
Right.
The changes in now with staffing platforms appear to have a similar impact, matching, you know, work and workers in a new way. But it really accelerates the growth of the entire staffing ecosystem. So I don't know, for me, you know, we're bullish on the future, and we believe that continued growth is available, you know, to those who really embrace the wave of change. You know, technology innovations will make staffing firms far more productive. And it's clear that COVID and the resulting crisis has raised the visibility and interest in more flexible ways of working. Which is good for all the players involved. It really, I think, is a great time to be in staffing, kind of the golden age of opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great industry to serve. It really is. It's been, you're right, it's resilient. And I love the industry and the partners in there, because they have a lot of respect for people and helping people put people to work. And
it's a noble cause, right?
Yes, it is. It's great. It's so great. Anything in ending and closing this up, anything else, Adrian? I mean, these are great, This is a great conversation and I appreciate it. But anything else, any last words? No.
Yeah, no, I'm just, you know, I really, you know, I've been doing this a little while, so have you, and I'm sure some of your listeners out there have too. And, you know, looking at, you know, from where we came, you know, 25 or more years ago to now, I mean, staffing's kind of sexy again, you know, it's yes. Like, we've never been this cool. So I'm looking forward to the next few years to see what happens. And, you know, I think we are resilient and we will grow. And again, I think it's a golden opportunity for staffing right now.
I agree with you. I agree. Well, thank you very much for your time today. I appreciate it. I will look forward to seeing you next week.
I can't wait.
At the Healthcare Summit in Boston. So thank you very much. You have a great afternoon. Thank you.
Thanks, Julie.